today we will be discussing about disarming diabetes. So, if you would notice, doon sa mga existing na mga patients who are developing fatal conditions in this time of pandemic are those that have the pre-existing conditions nga. These are the leading cause of death worldwide. So, lima ito kung titignan natin. So, included here is cardiovascular disease, respiratory disease, cancer, diabetes, and stroke. Now, this is the data from the World Health Organization, but this is also true in the Philippines. Okay? So, if you notice, all of these five are all lifestyle related. Yes, we have the infectious disease right now, pero kung titignan natin, this top five cause of death, it's also coexisting with a communicable disease. And more so, kung meron ka nitong mga communicable disease na to, this poses you more to the risk of developing fatal condition when you get infected with the current COVID-19 right now. Now, I have here the data from the Department of Health. These are the top 10 causes of death in the Philippines. So they were able to report this in February 2019. And you will see here that 24.4% of the death is caused by disease of the heart. Now, baba ako kaagad dun sa diabetes, ha, because that will be the topic for today. So yung diabetes comprises about 6% of the death. Okay? So total death. Now that is the report from the Department of Health. Ngayon, I'll show you another data here coming from the National Statistics Office or the NSO. So they are relatively the same. Looking at it, yung pinakamataas pa rin ang cause of death is ischemic heart disease. So ito yung may mga bara sa ugat ng puso. And then diabetes is right there. Now, I want to show you the numbers. This was reported in June 2019. Okay, so the reported deaths in 2017 is about 579,237. Okay, so kung ita-translate natin yan, the average would be about 1,500 to 1,600 deaths a day, per day. So kung gusto natin ng per minute, ibig sabihin, may isang taong namamatay kada minuto sa Pilipinas. Alright? Now, let me bring you to the numbers again. Okay? So, here is the number. If you will see in your screen right now, the number of daily deaths in ischemic heart disease is over 200. To be exact, this is 230 deaths secondary to ischemic heart disease daily. Okay? Let me go down to diabetes. In diabetes, 85 person is dying every single day of diabetes. Okay? So I'm not discounting the effect of COVID-19 because it's really necessary because this is an acute condition, this is a pandemic. But lest we forget, the non-communicable diseases, mas magkakasakit pa rin at mas mamamatay pa rin ang mga Pilipino. Alright? Now going back, again, there are about 85 Filipinos who are dying every single day of diabetes. This is diabetes, okay? Now, you might be asking me, why would I go straight to diabetes? Yung number one cause of death pala is cardiovascular disease, okay? Now, you will see here that diabetes, we call them sometimes as the mother of many types of diseases, no? Because looking at the complication of diabetes, just because they are affecting the blood vessels that would supply all our organs from head to foot, ibig sabihin, ang complication niya is also from head to foot, okay? So our eyes may be affected. Patients with diabetes may develop heart attack, stroke, peripheral artery disease. Yung mata apektado, they may develop cataract, they may develop glaucoma, diabetic foot, they may develop diabetic nephropathy, yung kidneys affected. And then they will also have peripheral neuropathy. Okay, so they have numbness, they have pain on the extremities, so on and so forth. Okay, so yes, number one cause of death is heart disease, but mind you, ang diabetes is really atherogenic. So let's discuss diabetes this time. So diabetes is included in those chronic diseases. Now, bakit natin uumpisahan sa diabetes? Now, you will see in your screen right now that diabetes is in fact declared as an epidemic in the Philippines since year 2019. Pag sinabi mong epidemic, eto, No? In fact, if I were to say, diabetes is a pandemic because it's been affecting the entire world. Kung titignan mo yung statistics, konting-konti yung COVID-19 compared to diabetes statistics that we have. But it's just that yung infectious disease kasi is an acute condition that we have to take care of it right away. Yung diabetes naman, ang pagkakaiba, this is a chronic condition and most patients with diabetes don't really feel anything, you know, until they are diagnosed with diabetes and marami nga sa kanila sinasabi pa, I don't really feel bad at all. Yung labs lang nagsasabi na may sakit ako. You know, so that's why medyo hindi rin sila nai-encourage na mag-change, to change into a healthy lifestyle. Now, actually, in this time of pandemic, I am starting to appreciate, you know, the efforts na ginagawa ng mga tao ngayon. Kasi people right now are more health conscious than ever. They don't want to get the infection or ayaw nilang ma-include doon sa fatality. Now, like I said, Philippines now is facing an epidemic of diabetes. And if you can see in your screen right now, one in every five Filipinos are already diabetic or pre-diabetic. Ikaw na nanonood ngayon, baka hindi mo alam na diabetic ka. You will never know unless you get yourself tested. Alright? So, if this is one in every five, bilangin mo kung ilang kayo dyan sa family ninyo. Okay, so if this is five adults living in one household, one among you may be diabetic already or pre-diabetic. So ngayon, pag-uusapan natin kaano ba talaga ang diabetes. Kasi dati ang alam natin, diabetes type 1 lang, diabetes type 2. Pero ngayon sa mga guidelines natin, may tinatawag na kasi tayo ngayon na pre-diabetes. If you notice, dati kapag nag-request ang doktor natin ano, ng blood sugar test, minsan nakikita natin to na medyo above the normal limit siya. So usually, ang sinasabi natin sa pasyente is borderline na sila, no? So ngayon, sa diabetes diagnosis, we already call it pre-diabetes. So sige, pag-usapan natin ngayon on kung paano mo masasabi na may pre-diabetes ka or may diabetes ka na. Okay? So ang makikita nyo sa screen nyo ngayon, you will see there, ito yung mga test na ginagamit natin to diagnose a patient na may diabetes. So ngayon, ginagamit na natin yung A1C, kasi yung A1C, yun yung nagbibigay ng average blood sugar natin in 2 to 3 months time. So doon natin nakikita kung controlled yung blood sugar ng pasyente or kung tama ba yung binibigay nating gamot, kung nag-work ba yung gamot sa kanya, or kung yung ating binibigay na advice sa kanya, ginagawa niya ba o hindi. Okay? So yun yung ginagamit natin. But usually, ang nakasanayan nating nire-request specifically ano, is the fasting blood sugar or yung FBS. Okay? So ito yung fasting glucose. Minsan naman ginagamit din natin yung oral glucose tolerance test. Or minsan tinatawag din natin yung postprandial. Okay? So just to be clear, pag diabetic ang pasyente, the A1C should be above 6.4. So, pag yung A1C nyo yung 6.5, magbibigay na tayo ng diagnosis na diabetic na yung pasyente. Or kung yung fasting blood glucose natin or fasting blood sugar is equivalent to 126 or more than 126 milligrams per DL in two separate occasions. That means dalawang beses. Kasi hindi ibig sabihin na one time lang yung nakaagad ng diagnosis. No? So, dalawang beses natin kukunan yan. So, if it's equivalent to 126 or more, that means diabetic na yung pasyente. At yung OGTT naman, or minsan yung postprandial test, tinitake din natin, if it's equivalent to 200 milligrams per DL or more, meaning ang pasyente ay diabetic na. What are the symptoms of diabetes? Of course, marami kasing nagsasabi may diabetes sila but they don't really have any symptom at all. But we have classic diabetes symptoms, okay? So first, frequent urination, lagi silang umiihi. Second, feeling of thirsty, lagi silang umiinom. And then, increase of appetite. They also have blurred vision and they always feel tired. So mamaya, mapag-uusapan natin, bakit ito yung mga simptoma ng mga may diabetes? You will always see them inom ng inom. Why? Kasi yung sugar mataas sa dugo. Okay? So the sugar is hyper-concentrating in the blood. And so it needs to be diluted with water. Kaya inom sila ng inom. So since inom sila ng inom, they will also urinate frequently. So, bakit sila kain ng kain? Kasi yung sugar hindi pumapasok sa cells. They stay in the blood vessel. Nasa ugat lang siya. Hindi siya pumapasok sa cell. So, your body thought they are hungry, so that's why they keep eating. Okay? So, we'll discuss further on that. The blurred vision usually happens as a complication of diabetes. And of course, feeling tired kasi walang energy yung cell. Kasi nga, yung sugar hindi nakakapasok doon sa cells. Okay, so diabetics should be aware of the following. Apat itong lagi natin sinasabi. Number one, numero uno, is heart health. Because a diabetic patient may not die of, say, renal failure, but they may die of ischemic heart disease. Okay, yung number one cause of death. Why? Because diabetic is an atherogenic condition. Ibig sabihin, nagpapanarrow siya ng ugat ng ating puso. Okay? So, kumikipot yung ugat ng puso natin, hindi nakakadalo na maayos yung dugo. Okay? So, that may cause ischemia. Number two na dapat pag-ingatan sa diabetic patients is the kidney function. Alright? So, kasi madalas sa kanila nagkakaroon ng end-stage renal disease just because of long-staying diabetes. Of course, kailangan ni pag-ingatan yung kanilang mata. Nakita natin doon sa complications kanina, yung pinakita natin doon sa screen, ano? So, they may develop cataract, they may develop glaucoma, and then they may develop also diabetic retinopathy. So, kung titignan mo, tatlong kondisyon kaagad yan just because of having high blood sugar. So, if you were to think of it, is it really worth it? Of with all these types of complication that you may have, nag-aabang sa'yo yon, you know, yung pang kakainin mo on your plate right now just because of that appetite you have, is really worth it, no? Ang mahirap lang kasi ngayon, these complications doesn't really happen right away. So, hindi siya nakakatakot kasi matagal pa siya mangyayari. And some other, and actually many patients won't appreciate the complications kasi nga, matagal pa siyang mangyari. Alright, so diabetes is in fact a multifactorial nature. So, bakit nagkaka-diabetes ang pasyente? Genetics is one factor. So, pwedeng yung parents mo may diabetes. Both sides, pwedeng may diabetes. But we also have the epigenetic. When you say epigenetic, ano yung naging behavior ng mother mo when you were in the womb? Alright? But the thing is, we are not predestined to have diabetes. Hindi ibig sabihin na kung yung parents mo may diabetes ka na rin. Alright? Because what I'm seeing right now, basically in my practice sa clinic, ano, kapag ako nagda-diagnose ng pasyente na may diabetes, say, nakita ko yung kanyang blood sugar, and this is the second test that we have. And then I would tell my patient, Mom, may diabetes na po kayo. You know, I am expecting to see a sad face. Parang yun ang ini-expect kong makita sa pasyente na malulungkot sila kasi may diagnosis na sila ngayon. But, unfortunately, hindi yun ang nakikita ko sa pasyente. Usually, I would see, oh, may diabetes na ako. Alam mo, Doc, kasi yung parents ko may diabetes din. Tapos yung kapatid ko may diabetes din. So, ngayon ako na yung may diabetes. So, parang tanggap na lang talaga nila na this time, it's their turn to have diabetes. It's not only the food intake, it's not only the lifestyle, it's not only the genetics, but this is multifactorial nature in the development of diabetes. Of course, included here is the lifestyle factor, ano yung kinakain natin, yung diet, exercise, the stress level of the person, and some other habits na meron siya. Of course, environmental factor and microbiome also plays a role. Now, here, I wanna let you see in your screen, the epigenetics in type 2 diabetes. These are the key influencers. So, ano yung positive influencer in terms of developing type 2 diabetes? So, you will see here the polyphenols that you can see from plant food sources, yung vitamins, no? Particularly vitamin B, exercise, stress reduction, and then the healthy diet of your parents will actually give you a positive result. Alright, so ibig sabihin, mas mataas ang chance na hindi ka magde-develop ng diabetes kahit na may genetic predisposition ka. But what are the negative key influencer? Of course, number one is sugar, refined sugar, alcohol, saturated fat, processed food, and the unhealthy parental diet. Kung anong kinakain ng parents mo when you were still in the womb while your parent is conceiving you. the key player in diabetes development, in fact, is the insulin resistance. Now, let me introduce you to your pancreas. Okay? Lapay sa Tagalog. Yung pancreas, katabi po yan, nasa bababanda ng ating stomach. Okay? So, katabi siya ng ating small intestine. Now, let's say this is a normal function of cell in your pancreas. So, your pancreas has beta cells. Yung beta cells na yon, yun yung nagpo-produce ng insulin. Okay? So, pag kumakain tayo, ang nangyayari, yung insulin, para siyang susi, bubuksan niya yung door, yung pinto, para makapasok yung glucose or yung sugar. Now, what's happening with type 1 diabetes? Doon naman sa type 1 diabetes, ibang usapan yon. Kung type 1 diabetes, ibig sabihin, walang insulin. So, ang nangyayari, yung sugar nandoon lang sa dugo. Hindi makakapasok doon sa cells kasi walang presence ng insulin. The only way for them to survive is for them to have exogenous sources of insulin. Yun yung type 1 diabetes. Doon naman sa type 2 diabetes, which is common right now and which comprises 90% of all diabetes in the world. So usually, yung pancreas dito is working properly. But the patient is also usually overweight. Okay? Now, ang nangyayari dito is that nandoon naman yung insulin, pero hindi lahat ng sugar nakakapasok doon sa cell. Why? There must be something gumming up the door. Hindi makapasok doon sa lalagyan ng susi. If you can see right now in your screen, I have here a figure to show you. This is a very short video. Na like if you're eating spaghetti, right? Pag kumakain ka ng spaghetti, what will happen is that you will put this in your mouth, no? And then, what will happen, yung sugar dapat na napuproduce, kasi nga carbohydrates yung spaghetti, di ba? So, ginagamit kasi ng sugar, ng ating muscle cells, yung sugar, for example. So, bakit sa muscle cell yung pag-uusapan natin? Because dito nag-uumpisa yung insulin resistance. Okay? Dito nakikita yung insulin resistance, I mean. So, what will happen is that, pag tayo kumain, yung carbohydrates, pupunta dapat sa ating dugo, and then when it's in the blood already, lalabas yung insulin coming from the pancreas. Doon sa ating muscle cell, may tinatawag tayong receptor doon for insulin. You will see there in your screen the receptor of the insulin. Didikit dyan sa receptor yung insulin. And then, it will activate series of reactions. Pag na-activate yung reaction na yun, lalabas ngayon yung glucose vesicle. Yun yung door kung saan papasok yung mga sugar coming from your blood going into the muscle cell. Now, how about in type 2 diabetes? What you will see here is, nakita niyo yung insulin, dumikit na dun sa receptor niya. Now, supposed to be, ma-activate siya, right? But due to the presence of intramyocellular fats, pag sinabi natin intramyocellular fats, eto yung fats na nasa loob ng ating muscle cells. So, they are actually triggering toxicity inside the muscle cell that causes the receptor not to respond doon sa insulin. That's why yung daanan ng glucose, yung daanan ng sugar, hindi na-activate. So that means just because of those fat na nasa loob ng cell, hindi ma-activate yung daanan para makapasok yung sugar. So what will happen is that, here, this is clearly seen in your screen, yung sugar nandoon lang sa dugo mo, wala sa loob ng muscle cell. Anong nandun sa loob ng muscle cell? Those are the intramyocellular fats. Okay? So, what's the relevance of that? The relevance is that causes insulin resistance. Ibig sabihin, maraming insulin na napoproduce yung pasyente, pero hindi nakakapasok yung sugar sa loob ng cell. And that is equivalent to having diabetes. Okay? Now, you will see here na yung intramyocellular lipid concentration actually decreases the sensitivity, insulin sensitivity of any individual consuming free fatty acids, fats, taba, mantika. Okay? Clear. Free fatty acids in just a matter of 3 hours after eating. approximately 3 hours after eating, and you will see in your screen kasi this is about 160 minutes, no? After about 3 hours of eating fats, taba, mantika, insulin sensitivity decreases. Nag-uumpisa na kaagad yung insulin resistance. Tanong, how many times are you eating in each day? Tatlo. Madalas sinasabi tatlo. But honestly, marami sa ating kumakain 5 times a day kasi may dalawang snacks pa tayo. Pero pa dun sa midnight snack ko minsan. Ano? Now, if you look at the 3 major meals na kinakain natin, if this is composed of saturated fat in particular, sa umaga, 3 hours after, bababa yung insulin sensitivity because of the presence of fats, right? Sa tanghali, kumain ka uli ng fats. After 3 hours, bababa uli yung insulin sensitivity. And then sa dinner, ganun din yung kinain mo, bababalin yung insulin sensitivity. And this will happen over and over again. And so, that is equivalent to developing diabetes type 2. Okay? Secondary to insulin resistance. Dati kasi, dati sa medisina, ang alam namin, what causes diabetes is the sugar. What causes diabetes? Yung asukal na kinakain. So right now, yes, this is the caloric load that you have. But unfortunately, what causes insulin resistance is the fat that we eat from the food every single day that causes insulin resistance. And I hope that's clear. Okay? Now, studies are showing that by age 20 years old, well-established na yung pancreas mo. Okay? Well-established na yung islets, the beta cells that produces insulin. However, just because of these free fatty acids, yung fats na kinakain natin, it causes death to the pancreatic cells. Alright? Just because of the lipotoxicity. Take note of that. So it's not only the increase in sugar that causes death to the pancreatic cell, but also the fat. More so with the fat. All right? So that in this research, it was found out na most probably, yung mga nadadiagnose ng type 2 diabetes have already 50% decrease in number of their pancreatic cells. And over time, bumababa pa yan ng about 20% depende doon sa pag-control nila ng blood sugar nila. Okay? Now, bottom line here, the consumption of hypercaloric diet, for example, which is rich in saturated fats, in the setting of unfavorable genetic background, ibig sabihin may family history ka ng diabetes, this is equals to pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes. So yung tatlong factor na yon, kung meron ka, magkaka-develop ka ng diabetes. No? I hope that is clear. You will notice type 2 diabetic patients started with a heavy weight. No, medyo malalaki sila, specifically may central obesity sila, pwedeng maliliit yung braso nila, maliliit yung binti nila, pero yung kanilang tiyan nandoon, nandoon yung fats, yung adipose cells, nandoon concentrated. So we call it central obesity. Okay? So now, in this study again, that was conducted, this is the Nurses' Health Study, the famous Nurses' Health Study. You will see here, one of their findings is that yung mga nasa highest end ng weighing scale, ibig sabihin yung mga overweight, they develop diabetes 40 times higher in frequency than those at the lower end. Ibig sabihin yung ideal ang kanilang body weight. Okay, so in this study, this was actually conducted at Harvard, this is a systematic review and meta-analysis with over 200,000 people that they were able to track for a decade. So they were able to find out that when a person consumes approximately 4 ounces or 113 grams ng unprocessed meat, ibig sabihin karne, ito yung mga unprocessed fresh meat na kinakain nila, when you consume 4 ounces of that every day, that will increase your diabetes risk by 20% already. Okay, so yun yung isang finding sila in this research. Now, another findings that they have, which is really very remarkable, is that if you took 2 ounces or 60 grams. Tignan mo kung ano yung 60 grams, no? Konting-konti kasi yan eh. Of processed red meat per day, this will increase your diabetes risk by 50%. So yung 60 grams na kinakain natin na processed meat, that will pose you to develop risk of diabetes 50%. Napakataas nun. So, ano example ng mga processed meat natin? Ito yung bacon, corned beef, meatloaf, sausages, hot dogs. So as long as you're consuming 60 grams of that every single day, so that increases your risk to develop diabetes at 50%. In your screen right now, you will see this is how it looks like when you put your muscle cell in the microscope. Okay, so you will see the fat droplets inside the muscle cell. So, dapat ang laman nito is glucose. However, due to insulin resistance, ang laman niya is fats. Okay? And so, typically, ito yung picture nung muscle cell nung pasyente na may diabetes. Okay, so much so about diabetes. What can we do pag ang pasyente may diabetes na? Now, let's start with researches again. Now, I will show you here some of the researches that utilizes lifestyle intervention. Ibig sabihin, ginamitan nila ng nutrition, physical activity, stress management, smoking cessation, and then adequate sleep. Okay, so this is one of the famous study na gusto kong i-present sa inyo ngayon, ano? So kung yung mga doktor na nakakapanood ng ating presentation ngayon, alam na alam nila yon, kasi this is what we call the Diabetes Prevention Program, or we call it DPP. Ito, this is a 3 years program, tatlong taong ginawa yung study, and in this study, they have about 3,000 obese pre-diabetic patients. So ibig sabihin, itong mga pasyente na to, malalaki sila. Matataba sila, no? They are at the obese category, and then they are pre-diabetic, hindi pa full-blown yung diabetes nila. Now, in this study, they explore the question of drugs or lifestyle. Now, in this case, ang pinag-aralan nila is metformin. So, ang ginawa nila, hinati nila yung 3,000 na participants into 3 groups, and then they track them for 3 years. Tinignan nila kung ano yung magiging clinical outcome. So, ibig sabihin, ini-investigate nila kung sino yung grupo na magkakaroon ng full-blown diabetes. Sino yung mas marami? Yung group 1? Yung group 1 kasi they were the placebo, so they were receiving the gummy pills. Hindi nila alam na yung tinitake nila is not really a medicine. And then yung group 2, sila yung binibigyan ng metformin. Yun yung gamot na basic na gamot na tinitake ng mga pasyente natin na may diabetes, right? And then yung group 3, ito yung group naman that are receiving intensive therapeutic lifestyle. So, ibig sabihin, they change the lifestyle. Ang goal nila is to lose 7% of those excess weight. Remember, the participants are obese patients. And then, they ask the participants to walk about 150 minutes every week. So, 30 minutes per week yan na physical activity. Now, at the end of the 3 years program, this is what they found. Yung first group who were receiving placebo, the gummy pills, 29% of them develop full-blown diabetes, and that's expected. Tatlong taon yun na. And then, yung second group, which are receiving medication, we are expecting na hindi lahat dapat makaka-develop ng diabetes because they're already receiving the medication. However, 22% sa kanila, nagkaroon pa rin ng full-blown diabetes. Alright? And you will see here, amazingly, yung group 3 who are receiving intensive therapeutic lifestyle, only 14% of them develop diabetes. So kung titignan natin, this is already a 58% benefit. Just changing the lifestyle and reducing the weight. This is another study that was published in the Journal of Applied Physiology, a Dr. Neil Barnard study, that at the end of 4 weeks residential lifestyle program, now what I'm trying to let you see here is apat na linggong lifestyle change. 4 weeks. Okay? So isang buwan na lifestyle change. So that means they use nutrition, physical activity, stress reduction, enough sleep, smoking cessation. Okay? So what happened after 4 weeks of lifestyle program, 76% of participants were off their oral drugs. ibig sabihin they don't need the medications anymore because their blood sugar were at the normal level already. And then 44% were off their insulin for those who were taking insulin shots. This is one of the earliest study in diabetes. This is a study conducted by Dr. Inder Singh. Now, meron siyang 80 patients who are taking insulin already. These are patients on insulin. Now, ang ginawa ni Dr. Inder Singh, he placed these patients into 11% calories from fat. Now, normally what we're eating right now is about 35% of fat. Now, in this set of patients, 80 patients were placed into 11% calories with fat. And you know what happened? After 6 weeks, being on this diet, 50 out of 80 were off insulin already. And then, after another 18 weeks in the program, another 18 of them were off insulin. Now, if you look at your screen right now, you will see that this is about 85% success rate by utilizing lifestyle changes only as early as 1955. Now, yung mga pinapakita kong research sa inyo, matagal nang ginawa yan. Recently, in your screen, you will see here, this is the latest algorithm that we use when we manage type 2 diabetes. Okay, 2019 ito nilabas by the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists and American College of Endocrinology. You will see here in the pre-diabetes algorithm, ibig sabihin ng pre-diabetes, they're not full-blown diabetic yet, but hey, take note, you don't have to have full-blown diabetes to develop complications. Kasi maraming matagal ng pre-diabetic and then right now, full-blown diabetic sila, but they have the complications already. So that's why we already have the algorithm now na kailangan i-manage yung pasyente kahit nasa pre-diabetes stage pa lang sila. Now, you will see in this algorithm, top of the line, number one, nandyan sa taas, lifestyle therapy. Okay? Again, this is 2019 algorithm. Yung pinakita ko sa inyo earlier in the researches were done 1955, 2003, 2002. Now, this time, in this management guideline that we have, 2019, lifestyle therapy is number one in terms of managing patients with pre-diabetes. Ito naman yung sa glycemic control. You will see here, again, for patients who are already diagnosed with diabetes, you will see their lifestyle therapy, which is first in the line. So, again, the researches that are done this time, in this generation, are only validating the researches that were already done prior. In that guideline that I showed you, you will see here the composition of the lifestyle therapy. Now, in this time, this is already the American College of Endocrinology that is describing kung ano yung gagawin doon sa treatment for diabetes. This is the same thing that those people in the old times were doing. Pareho lang ang binigay nilang recommendation. First, nutrition. Number two, physical activity. Number three, sleep, behavioral support, and smoking cessation. Okay? So, science before is being validated by science now.
Although we can see that there is a difference between implementation and how intensive is lifestyle medicine intervention implemented to patients with diabetes in the studies before and in the guidelines implemented now.
Okay? So, here, let's start with lifestyle intervention one, which is nutrition. So, what we usually give to patients with diabetes, kailangan lower caloric intake. That will result to weight loss and improve the A1C. Okay? O yung, ito yung test na ginagawa natin for diabetes. Total caloric intake. As long as you're eating whole food plant-based diet, it's really hard to overeat. Diba? So, example, if you eat potato, patatas, how can you even finish 5 large potatoes in one sitting? Mahirap, diba? Yes, you may consume 5 large potatoes in 5 days maybe, 3 days maybe. But in one sitting, you can easily finish 1 tube of Pringles, right? yung one tube of Pringles having about 1,000 calories is just the same of the calories you will get from those huge potatoes that you may be able to finish for 3 days, 5 days. Pero yung isang Pringles, yung isang potato chips, isang upuan mo lang, wala pa isang oras, ubus mo na yan. And that is calorie-laden food. Okay? So that's why in whole food plant-based diet, mahirap mag-overeat. Okay, I'll give you another example. Very classic. If you eat unpolished rice, this is brown rice, 1 cup of unpolished rice, halos hindi mo maubos. But if you eat refined rice, which is white rice, yung isang cup, kulang na kulang. Okay? Parang hindi umabot sa chan. Parang kailangan pa ng another 1 or another 2 cups for you to get filled. So that's how important it is to eat whole food plant-based diet, specifically in patients with diabetes. Why? You will see in the screen right now that whole food plant-based diet improves insulin sensitivity, the health of your beta cells, it normalizes angiogenesis, it lowers the overall endothelial cell injury that was brought about by increased blood sugar. Okay, so why are we talking about whole food plant-based here? Please take note that plant-based diet is totally different from whole food plant-based diet. Okay, ano yung difference niya? Again, potato chips is plant-based. It's vegan, no? Pero yung whole food plant-based is patatas. Alright, nakita niyo yung difference? So, yung kamote Q, how do you say it? Diba yung kamote, piniprito, nilalagyan ng asukal. So, yung kamote cure, kamote chips, whatever you call it, that is still plant-based food, right? But it's processed. But the kamote na nilaga, that is whole. So, anong difference nila in terms of calorie? Few slices of this kamote with all the sugar and all the oil in there is totally higher than the calorie you will get from one piece of that kamote that is boiled, okay? So, I hope that's clear. Now, with lifestyle intervention, we really wanted that patients would take more of the fiber. You will see here that increasing fiber intake will improve glycemic control, will enhance insulin sensitivity. Of course, it will decrease cholesterol kasi yung ating mga soluble fibers, they bind with the cholesterol. Okay? Para hindi lahat ng cholesterol na kinakain mo makakarating doon sa blood. And of course, it improves satiety. Remember that fibers absorbs water. So much so that when it reaches your stomach, it expands. Kaya parang mas nabubusog ka. When you take food or plant-based food that are high in fiber. Now, let me emphasize one thing here with diabetes. Remember, in diabetic patients, there is impaired angiogenesis. Okay? Yung angiogenesis, in fact, this is the development of new blood vessels. Halimbawa, nagkaroon ng injury, dapat nagkakaroon ng new blood vessels there to promote healing. Pero ito yung nawawala sa mga pasyente na may diabetes. That's why they have the increased risk to have poor wound healing. Meron silang peripheral neuropathy, meron silang diabetic retinopathy, meron silang renal disease, some of them may develop cancer, and some of them may develop cardiovascular disease. I don't know, for whatever it's worth, for patients with diabetes, ang kailangan lang talaga, ibaba yung blood sugar the soonest you can and maintain them. Okay? So, lahat ng complication na pinag-uusapan natin is not totally worth it. Alright? So, these are the foods that may optimize angiogenesis. What you can see in your screen right now includes many of the food na meron tayo na makikita natin locally. Okay, so it includes bok choy or pet chai, cauliflower, broccoli, nandiyan din yung soybean, tomatoes is also included, all the berries, pineapple, apples. But of course, if the patient is having increased blood sugar, yung timing ng pagkain, of course, ng fruits, especially if they are sweet, they should be taken more in the morning kasi mas active sila. No? And less at night dahil matutulog na lang sila. Now, number two lifestyle intervention is physical activity. So this is quite simple. When we say physical activity, if diet works with diabetes, physical activity works the same with diabetes. So basically, this is only 30 minutes moderate physical activity with strength training 5 days in each week. Again, you just have to do the talk test. Ibig sabihin kung anong ginagawa mong exercise, as long as you can still talk and you can sing, that is actually low intensity physical activity. Pero kapag hindi ka na makakanta, you can still talk but you cannot sing anymore, you are at the moderate intensity of physical activity. But let me emphasize sa mga pasyente na may diabetes, nagdadagdag po tayo ng strength training. Ano ibig sabihin ng strength training? Kailangan po may weights, no? So, pwede mong gamitin yung body weight mo or you can use improvised weights that you have. Why? Because when the muscle is contracting, no? Pag nagko-contract yung muscle, it utilizes glucose and it helps insulin sensitivity. Okay? So that's why in patients with diabetes, we never allow them and we really discourage them na wala silang ginagawa more than 2 days. No? Kasi maganda yung effect ng physical activity to the insulin sensitivity. Okay? So again, 30 minutes moderate physical activity with strength training or weights, 5 araw sa isang linggo. Okay? Now, you will also see here the next lifestyle intervention, which is stress management. Now, any person who is stressed may have increased stress hormone. And an increase in stress hormone may increase blood sugar as well. So, in fact, a lot of study would show you that stress management improves long-term glycemic control. Okay? So, pero kung nakikita nyo dito sa screen ninyo ngayon, you will see here another factor. We encourage patients with diabetes to have outdoor activity. Okay? Outdoor activity. You will notice right now, specifically for those patients living in the urban area, we have this what we call NDD, or the Nature Deficit Disorder. Yung mga nakatira sa syudad. May pangalan na siya ngayon, Nature Deficit Disorder, because we are bound in the four corners of this building, nasa walls lang tayo ng mga bahay natin, and in fact, we are living in an artificial jungle. Ano ibig sabihin ng artificial jungle? Nasa syudad ka, ang daming mga buildings na nandyan. You're in the artificial jungle. So a lot of patients right now are having nature deficit disorder. Now there is this pyramid that we have that I showed you. Nakikita nyo sa screen nyo ngayon. This is nature connection pyramid. What do you do? Okay? So here as advice, daily, there should be outdoor nature play. Ibig sabihin, pwede kang pumunta sa garden mo, mag-garden ka everyday. Next is nature exploring weekly. So, ibig sabihin nature walk, you may visit places once in a week. And then monthly, you can go monthly outing, you know, with your regional, kung saang farm na pwede mong i-visit. And then yearly, you can go, pwede kang mag-visit sa wild. Go to the mountains or go to the lakes, kung lakes, go to the beaches, etc. You recharge yourself with the nature. You reconnect with nature. So check this out. We call this nature connection pyramid. And then lastly, in managing stress is rest. Okay? When we say rest, a patient should have enough sleep, 7 to 8 hours, kung actively working ka. Because it's only during sleep that our cells can recuperate. Remember, pag hindi tayo nakatulog, our body recognizes and interprets inadequate sleep as stress. Okay? So, pag hindi ka nakatulog, the night prior, the following day, cortisol hormone is high, blood sugar is high. Okay? So, in rest, it's not only enough sleep. So we included here Sabbath in the rest. Now when we say Sabbath, this is a single day in the week that you are resting together with the Lord. You know, personally, I can't imagine myself without Sabbath in a week. So kahit ang nature goes with the Sabbath, goes with a day of rest. In fact, in organic agriculture and natural farming, we call this fallow. Ibig sabihin ng fallow, when you farm the land for 6 years, on the 7th year, you have to you have to have it rested. Hindi mo siya tataniman. So it can fully recover. So yung mga organic matters mag-develop. So that is happening in nature. It is written in the Bible. It's in the scripture. And your body needs it too. Okay? So that's included in rest. Okay, so I want to emphasize here some other added benefits that you will have in lifestyle intervention. These are the last few slides. First is we are protecting your pancreatic beta cells. Remember I told you earlier, when you are diagnosed with diabetes, most probably 50% of your pancreatic cells are not already functioning very well. Pag hindi mo pa na-control yan over time, about 20% of that na-degrade din. So what we do with lifestyle intervention is to protect your pancreatic beta cell to function very well. Next, in lifestyle intervention, you are not only improving glucose, you're not only improving blood sugar, but we are also normalizing the lipid profile. Yung ating cholesterol bumababa din. Yung lipid profile natin bumababa din. And then, there is also down-regulation of inflammatory processes. And that is one of the most important thing that is happening when you have lifestyle change. Yung inflammation sa katawan natin bumababa, basically because you're reducing your weight, you are having anti-inflammatory diet as well. And then lastly, it stabilizes your immune system. Remember, diabetic patients are considered immunocompromised because the glucose hinders the function of the immune cells in general. So when we have lifestyle intervention, when you improve your lifestyle, when you are a diabetic, it stabilizes your immune system in many different mechanisms. Okay? Now, lifestyle intervention reduces pain, secondary to peripheral neuropathy. It improves diabetic retinopathy. It will also help you overcome with food addiction and food dependency because this is the problem with patients with diabetes. With lifestyle intervention, it helps you reprogram your taste buds. And it will help you naturally detoxify your body as well. And then lastly, dun sa dalawa na added effect when you have lifestyle intervention is that it is cost-effective. Wala naman po siyang gastos. Okay? You don't spend anything here. In fact, mas makakasave ka pa. No, specifically when you change into whole food plant-based diet, you will realize that your expenditure with food will totally decrease. And then lastly, this is sustainable. Okay? Since this is cost-effective, not much of an expense, of course, this will be sustainable. All right? So I'd just like to summarize here. How do we disarm diabetes? First, we have to eat whole food plant-based diet with low saturated fat and high in fiber. Pangalawa, regular moderate intensity physical activity with strength training kasama yung weights, 30 minutes limang araw sa isang linggo. And the next, quit smoking. And the next, stress management, which includes adequate sleep, outdoor activity, and rest. Now remember, diabetes is the mother of all disease. What we see right now is that diabetes is affecting both young and old, walang exempted. The youngest patient I have with diabetes type 2 is 11 years old. Dati, diabetes, you can be at your 40s. Now, you can be at your 14. So, diabetes is affecting both young and old, basically because of the lifestyle that we have, the lifestyle and the routine that we do every single day. But one good news here is that we can do something. If this is lifestyle related, we just have to modify our lifestyle, learn about lifestyle modification, educate yourself, and then start living a healthy lifestyle. Always remember that living a healthy lifestyle is the cheapest way of giving yourself a good health care, because having a disease right now may be a disaster.